11th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in this session. Before I begin, can I take this opportunity to remind people about the Parliament's rules on social distancing? And if you are moving around the room or entering the room or exiting the room, if you could wear a face covering. The first item on our agenda is to agree to take items 3 and 4 in private. Is that agreed? Thank you. The second item on our agenda is to consider an Audit Scotland Section 22 report into the National Records Scotland office. And we have a number of witnesses with us this morning. Can I take the opportunity of, first of all, welcoming the Auditor General for Scotland, Stephen Boyle, who joins us in the committee room. We've also got remotely, but I'm glad to see joining us Graham Sampson, who's a senior auditor, Asif Hazib, who's a senior manager of audit services, and Darshi Sanzakumaran, who's the correspondence manager, performance audit and best value at Audit Scotland. So you are all very welcome indeed. And can I say that the Auditor General usually invites in his colleagues at the appropriate juncture, but if any of you do want to come in and haven't been spotted, if you could use the chat room function and put R in there. Can I also extend that invitation to Willie Coffey, who joins us remotely as well this morning, and I will bring Willie in as we go through the meeting and the questions. We have got questions, but I would like to invite the Auditor General to give us an opening statement. Stephen.
Good morning, Convener. Thank you. I'm presenting this report on the 2021 audit of the National Records of Scotland under Section 22 of the Public Finance and Accountability Scotland Act 2000. NRS is a non-ministerial department of the Scottish Government, and it is responsible for Scotland's census. The census is a vital source of information about Scotland's people and households. It's a large and complex programme, covering all of Scotland's estimated 2.51 million households and 5,500 communal establishments. As a result of the COVID-19 pandemic, ministers decided to defer the planned 2021 census until 2022. I've prepared this Section 22 report to highlight some of the challenges that NRS has faced delivering the census programme, including disruption to the original rehearsal timetable. I also report on the programme's use of project assurance reviews. In February 2020, one of these reviews assessed that NRS would have been ready to go with the original census in March 2021. Shortly thereafter, however, at the start of the pandemic, NRS carried out a detailed options appraisal to assess whether the census could go ahead in March 21 as planned. However, in considering the risks, in particular to data quality in Scotland, it was assessed that these were too high. Unlike the Office for National Statistics, which manages the census in England and Wales, NRS does not have access to additional sources of administrative data which would have enabled it to fill gaps in census returns caused by a low response rate. The auditor has highlighted that the decision to delay the census will cost an additional £21.6 million on top of the original £117 million budget. The Scottish Government is funding these extra costs, but it's important that NRS continues to closely monitor and manage programme spend. Scottish Government assurance reviews report that NRS improved its project management and delivery over the project, and that it is now on track to deliver the revised date of March 2022. As with any major ICT project, NRS will need to maintain momentum and closely manage and monitor risks over the final stages of the project, Convener. As ever, myself and my colleagues are delighted to answer the committee's questions this morning. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Auditor General, and we do have quite a number of questions that we want to put to you and to your team, based on our reading of the report and the kind of wider context in which it sits. And part of that wider context, and you mentioned it in your opening statement, is our concern about ICT projects not necessarily delivering on time and on budget. As a passing reference in the Section 22 report, it mentions that this is one of the biggest ICT projects in Scotland. And I just wondered, therefore, if you could tell us a bit more about what shape that takes. Is it an in-house ICT project? Is it a new capital project? Or are we just talking about the operational side of it?
Yeah. Morning, Convener. I'll do my best to start, actually, and I'll invite colleagues to supplement my response. So, yes, we do refer to it as one of the largest ICT projects, and the committee, in the reports that it receives from the Scottish Government as part of the major ICT projects, updates they receive have identified this as one of the significant projects. The costing of the project is not... All ICT projects take a different shape and form. The overall cost envelope that we refer to in the report of £117 million is analysed in a range of factors. Some of that will be ICT components, but as ever with many ICT programmes, much of that is staff costs in terms of development activity, coding and so forth, as well as the typical aspects of licensing of software and so forth. So there's a range of different components to what makes up the project. In terms of its significance, yes, we do cite that, Convener, but I think what we also see in the report is we think that this differs from previous reports in terms of successful ICT programmes on the basis that we've seen how the programme has interacted particularly with the assurance reviews, that where it has encountered challenges, the assurance reviews have helped and been able to steer the project back on course. Nonetheless, a hugely significant and complex programme nonetheless.
So are you saying then that you're satisfied about where things are with the ICT programme in terms of the skill sets required to oversee and run it, in terms of... its operational implementation? I mean, when we look at the census as carried out in England and Wales, that was a kind of digital first census, wasn't it, really, for the first time? And I just wonder whether your assessment is, in Scotland, we are at a stage where we could carry out that digital first assessment, or are there still any deficiencies or inadequacies?
So there was the intention for the census was to be a predominantly digital census. In terms of some statistics around that colleagues can keep me right on this actually, but if they will. But in previous census, Scotland also deployed a field force. So we'll all be familiar with people going round doors, supporting completion rates, accuracy of responses, and that historically was around 7,000 people. Had been deployed to deliver that part of the census programme. The intention for the 21 census was that number would have halved to 3,500 people. Still significant, but certainly an indication of a much broader digital first convener in terms of the delivery of the census. So I don't think we're saying that there are deficiencies. It was undoubtedly a large, complex programme. We do refer to in the report that there were aspects that were challenging in terms of the delivery of the original planned rehearsal, that there were changes in leadership during the lifetime of the programme, significant aspects that we identify in our 2017 report on the successful factors around the delivery of ICT programmes. But I think the wider picture of this report is that, as with all large complex programmes, it had challenges, but that these were addressed during the course of the programme. But it is maybe worth coming back to some of the differences between Scotland's arrangements and those elsewhere in the rest of the UK.
But there had been earlier difficulties, hadn't there, before the pandemic struck? When I look at the audit report from 2018-19, it speaks in there about a census recovery plan, kind of two, three years out from the expected date the census was going to be carried out. So there have been some underlying problems even before we got to the pandemic. I think that's fair, isn't it?
No doubt. There's no doubt that there had been challenges in the delivery of this project. In and of itself, I think there's some mitigation for a large complex project that it's not entirely unexpected that there would have been challenges. I think what matters more is how those challenges were dealt with. So the example that we refer to in the report, and I'll maybe ask Asif to say a word or two about this, is that the census rehearsal was delayed, and this aligned with one of the project assurance reviews that gave a red rating. A recovery plan that you refer to, convener, was implemented, and then a delayed rehearsal subsequently took place, evaluated ongoing project assurance arrangements alongside that, that led to the judgment that they could deliver it. But I'll pause for a moment and invite Asif, as the appointed auditor, who may wish to say a word or two more about those circumstances.
Thank you, Auditor General. Yes, the rehearsal was delayed. It was successfully carried out. It was carried out digitally based on three local authorities. And based on that, the assurance framework gave it the go-ahead to carry out the census.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful. I'm going to move on, and we're going to return to quite a lot of those themes around staffing and support and some of the implications for the delay. Just a couple of quick questions from me. One is, obviously the delay has meant that data will be delayed in reaching public sector planners, those people responsible for delivering services, which the census is in no small measure designed to inform that decision making. Have you made any assessment of then the impact of the delay on those kind of planning decisions that public authorities will need to make?
No, convener, we've not done any detailed work on the longer term implications of what that might mean. I think in terms of a 12-month delay, and then I think there'll be implications for budgets, resourcing, delivery of public services, no doubt. We think that's probably a matter for NRS and the Scottish Government to determine what the implications of those are, and if it's an interest to the committee, perhaps to pursue directly with those organisations.
Thank you. Yeah, we may well have the accountable officer in from NRS at a future evidence session. And again, this may fall into the same category as that, but I just wonder whether you or your team have got a view, Auditor General, about what the implication would be were there to be any further delay to the census, and the census has planned to go ahead in March 22 for reasons that we could speculate about doesn't go ahead.
So you're right, convener. I think with the circumstances that we're all witnessing, that the predictability that we used to have, isn't there. So it's not beyond the realms of possibility that there could be a further delay. And the circumstances are that the Scottish model still relies on a component of a field force. We've seen that in arriving at the decision to defer when the pandemic struck, NRS, in discussion with Scottish ministers, presented a range of options as to how they might deliver an alternative census. And I suppose it will be, again, as you infer, it will be a matter for discussion between NRS and the Scottish Government if it's a delay again, or whether there are alternative options to proceed. Clearly, a further 12-month delay wouldn't be desirable, but it may be a factor in NRS's own contingency planning as to how they would deal with that and what it meant for future planning of delivery of public services.
Thanks. I'm going to bring Craig Hoy in a minute. But just so you mentioned the options appraisal. I mean, all that I've seen that's in the public domain, I think, is two sides of A4. Have you had access as Audit Scotland to what presumably would be a much more detailed analysis that was put to the Census Programme Board or the Board of NRS? Have you had access to a much more detailed report? And would this committee be able to get access to that?
So I'll ask the team to come in just to say about what we've seen coming through. I'll maybe ask Darcy to comment on that, on the the NRS Programme Board, which is responsible for the management of the programme. In terms of the committee's access, I'm fairly clear, Convener, if it's something that the committee would wish to see the detail of some of the what lay behind the Programme Board's decision-making and associated advice, that's something that you would be, I'm sure, appropriate to pursue directly with NRS. If we have any of those details, we can discuss how best we can share that with the committee. But I'll ask Darcy just to comment on what we've seen. Thank you.
Thanks, Auditor General. Yes, we don't have the detailed options appraisal report, but we have seen numerous reports going to the Census Programme Board, also to the Economy and the Scottish Government, reporting on the decision-making process and the implications for that. So we've seen more detail than is in the summary that's published on the website, including details of the financial implications for the delay and more about the reasoning behind the decision to delay in terms of data quality and the impact on that if they had gone ahead in 2021.
Okay, thank you. And I think if we can get access to that more detailed work, it would be useful for us to do that. I think it's Colin Beattie who's got a number of questions next that he wants to ask. So, Colin, over to you.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to explore a little bit more about the management of the census programme. But before I do, General, we recall that in the past we've had Section 22 reports previously on this particular organisation. A lot of it was around ICT at that time. A lot of it was about management. Given that we're talking about this being one of the biggest ICT programmes that the Scottish Government has underway, have any steps been taken to give additional support with that memory of what happened previously? And also, just on the back of that, if we see a lot of the Section 22 reports coming forward, a lot of them have been for similar organisations, these departments that seem to be a little bit too remote, I think, in some ways, from control. Again, coming back, this is the biggest ICT project. What was done to provide the extra support on this?
Right. So, in all of those points, Mr. Beattie, I would say yes, additional support was provided by the Scottish Government in terms of expertise through two aspects. That one would say the additional support through the assurance reviews were undoubtedly helpful, and we've seen that the assurance review findings have ranged. So we know we started at red at one point that we've referred to for the rehearsal, with recommendations, and then to various stages of amber, and most recently now amber green. So that in itself is a key component of the delivery of a complex project. We've also seen, I think, NRS themselves taking appropriate leadership interventions at the right points. One of the assurance reviews, for example, found that there needed to be additional leadership around the programme. And at that point, the chief executive of NRS stepped in to, himself to become the senior responsible officer for the project.
He couldn't recruit someone to take that position.
So I think that was the third point I was going to make, yes. So that the programme had a change of director leading the project. So in difficulties in retaining, recruiting to that post, the chief executive took direct responsibility for that. I think that's an appropriate step for the leader of the organisation to take. But that the organisation has also supplemented that with additional skills, and particularly brought in expertise from external providers to support the running and the delivery and project expertise of the project. So I think all of that tells a story of a programme that has had challenges over its lifetime, but the greater scheme of judgments around the programme is that it's made the right decisions at points of challenge.
Well, let's talk about something the convener touched on. We were talking about the impact of COVID-19 on the census programme, which is substantial. But as you yourself said, there were challenges to the programmes identified before the pandemic. Can you give us a bit of detail around what these challenges specifically were and what the steps were that were taken to meet them?
Yeah, two things actually, and I'll ask colleagues to come in and say a word or two perhaps about the rehearsal for the census was one of the, I suppose, the initial red flag, and it was a red assurance review about the delivery of that. And then the other one that we just touched on in discussion, Mr. Beattie, of the changes in leadership. I'll perhaps start with Darcy, but Asif and Graham might want to say a word or two more just to give the committee a bit more detail.
Thanks, Auditor General. So there were a number of issues that were flagged when the programme was initially marked red. One of those was around preparedness for the rehearsal. That not all of the components required for testing the field workforce had been procured at that point. And so there were risks to the delivery of the rehearsal as planned in October 2019. They'd also identified deficiencies in programme governance and problems with resourcing and accessing the right level of skilled resource, particularly around programme management and some of the kind of operational skills required. And there were also some finance risks. So, subsequent to that, the recovery plan was implemented and a number of steps were taken. The Auditor General has already mentioned some of those. The Chief Executive took on responsibility as Senior Responsible Officer. They also commissioned an external programme and project management consultant to review the programme governance, and they implemented a number of changes following that. The Chief Executive also took over as Chair of the Census Programme Board, and they brought in a wider range of people onto the board. They brought in people from Scottish Government Finance and also staff from ONS and NISRA onto that group to bring in their expertise. And they also brought in additional resources onto the programme, including a new head of commercial and contract management, a new finance lead, additional program management resource and cybersecurity expertise as well. So they brought in a number of changes to try and address those deficiencies. And by February 2020, the rating of the program had changed and it was judged that they would have been able to proceed in 2021 with the census as planned, had it not been for the COVID-19 pandemic.
These deficiencies that were identified in the programme sound remarkably familiar in terms of other ICT programmes. It doesn't sound like it's anything new. So you would have thought they would have been addressed from the beginning, as opposed to coming out during the rehearsal. Are they not similar? Are they not the same problems that come up again and again?
So I think it's hard to argue against that, Mr. Beattie. I think that there are parallels in terms of the findings that Audit Scotland made in its 2017 report and some of the early circumstances that we're reporting here. I think there's perhaps something of an overlap in timescales. I mean, Exhibit 1, we set out the kind of timescale of the programme, and this is a programme that went back to 2015 in its infancy through to present day. So that's not to say that there weren't opportunities for learning or anticipation of some of these issues right at the start. There probably were. I think what we see differently in this project, as opposed to some of the more recent examples that the committee have seen of deficiencies in ICT projects, is that the organisation has learned and has intervened so that, you know, whilst there were challenges, it has been able to steer a complex programme back on course, and there's nothing for us to see here that had it not been for the pandemic, it would have delivered it on timescale and on budget.
Which probably brings me to the Scottish Government's technical assurance framework. I mean, these reviews are intended to improve the delivery of such programmes. Can you tell us a bit more about these assessments that were made and how they were considered?
Delighted to. I'll start actually, and Darcy might want to come in again just to say a bit more about how these operate. The technical assurance framework, the reviews are overseen by the Scottish Government's Directorate of Internal Audit and Assurance. This arrangement had previously been carried out by the Office of the Chief Information Officer of the Scottish Government. When those departments merged with Internal Audit, it's now overseen by the Director of Internal Audit and Assurance. And it's intended to review progress against key milestones of the project, flag up any risks. The committee will be familiar with aspects of gateway reviews, which looks to assess the delivery against key milestones and risks. It's been a feature, I'd probably say a welcome feature, Mr. Beattie, of this project. Arguably, you might say that some of that has been in parts reactive and intervention when aspects of the programme have steered off course. But in overall terms, I think we would cite that the technology assurance framework, the gateway process, has been a really positive feature of this programme. But again, I'll pause and ask Darcy if there's anything that she wished to say about some of the specifics of the rating systems and what that have meant, and then any recommendations that have flown out of the gateway reviews. Darcy.
Yes, I think what we've seen with the process of the TAF reviews, and they're a mixture of different kinds of reviews. There are what are referred to as go live gates later on in the process, and there are health check reviews, but all of them essentially assess where the programme is against planned milestones. And since the original rating of red back in 2019, what we've seen is as the subsequent reviews have come about, that there has been constant progress with each subsequent review. And the most recent one that was carried out at the end of November, and we have seen the findings from that, and the programme is now rated at amber green, and that is consistent with what would be expected of a project of this scale and complexity at this stage. So the review team said they do now have a high level of confidence that the programme will be able to go ahead as planned. And what we've also seen with these reviews is where they're used as the basis for assessing progress with the programme by the Census Programme Board, by the Audit and Risk Committee. So NRS have taken these reviews seriously and used them to implement changes where necessary and make good progress on the recommendations.
Just to take that step further, the report states that the appraisal which was undertaken by NRS concluded that any of the options to deliver the census in 2021 would represent a significant risk to data quality. What were the options that were being considered? And were all these options decided against only because of the drop in response rate that was anticipated? And where there's reference to potential bias in data, does that refer to the distortion caused by the drop in the response rate?
So I'll do my best to answer that actually, but we're drawing from material that we've seen from NRS, and it may be that NRS, in terms of its the thinking behind its statistical analysis and methodology, may be better placed to go into some of that in a bit of detail. What we've drawn from, though, Mr. Beattie, is paragraph 9 to the report. We set out what the various options of the appraisal, and just for the record, they were going to continue with the original census as planned, allow online completion but without the field force, aspects of online and paper with no field force, or only paper with no field force, or delay. And I think it's that point of the presence of the field force being key to giving assurance to NRS around the data quality issues that they deemed that there wasn't sufficient mitigation in place around data quality without the presence of the field force. And it's maybe in terms of overall data quality, but perhaps completion rates as well. And there's Asif mentioned earlier that the rehearsal was undertaken in three local authority areas, West Niles, Glasgow and Dumfries and Galloway. And the completion rates for there were around, if memory serves me correct, I think just over 20% completion rate for an online-only exercise of the rehearsal. So both concerns around data quality and overall completion rate, it would appear, informed the judgment that NRS and ministers took. But in terms of the specifics of how the methodology might have been disrupted, NRS would probably be a better place to give you that detail.
Okay. Moving on, just a couple of last questions. In England, they went ahead with their census. And part of the justification of that appears to be that administrative data from other public bodies were used in England and Wales to supplement data gaps. But the report says this wasn't available for Scotland. Is it that NRS were unable to access the data? Does the ONS not have the necessary data for Scotland? What was the reason behind that?
Darcy may want to say a word or two more again, actually, but the circumstances for the delivery of census through the census-taking bodies across the UK are such that the ONS is responsible for England and Wales, the Northern Ireland Statistics and Research Agency responsible for Northern Ireland, and NRS for Scotland. The methodologies used in England and Wales, and by extension aspects within Northern Ireland, allowed for the use of data held by other public bodies, such as HMRC and DWP. NRS has shared with us that they didn't have those options. We are aware that aspects of the reason behind that, about data sharing arrangements, the quality of data held by other public bodies for Scotland, was such that these were barriers to NRS having administrative data. Clearly, this is significant, Mr. Beattie. So just to say, I mean, this is really kind of part of the crux of the matter and the report, that, and hence the divergence in approaches undertaken in Scotland and the rest of the UK, and the additional cost as a consequence of that. So I'll pause before I invite Darcy, if you want to come back on that.
It was just to ask for clarification whether the information was actually refused, perhaps for data protection purposes or whatever, or is it that the data doesn't actually exist for Scotland as a separate database?
So Darcy may be able to answer. I'm not sure we've heard that there was a refusal. Rather, I think there was that the data was deemed not to be accessible, either through it didn't exist, or that data sharing arrangements prevented its wider sharing. Darcy may be able to give a bit more detail, though.
So our understanding is that prior to the pandemic, and quite a number of years before, I think ONS had started a long-term project to try and arrange the data sharing agreements necessary to be able to access these other sources of administrative data from the DWP and HMRC, for example. And so this has been a long-term project, and at the point at which they were making the decision about whether the census could go ahead, they hadn't yet completed it, but they had got to a stage where they felt that they had enough access to be able to supplement any gaps in the census data if they needed to. So currently Scotland does not have those arrangements in place. My understanding is that they are in the process of trying to get access to those other sources of data, but again, as I said, it's a long-term project and they are still in the early stages of that. But I think you'd need to confirm with NRS exactly where they are in that process.
Okay.
So because of that, not having access to the data meant that there were no options for NRS in terms of having other sources to supplement any gaps in the census data if they arose.
And just one last question. Obviously, there is a cost to the delay, and it's not inconsiderable, but are there any other disadvantages? Is Scotland disadvantaged in any way by that one-year delay?
So I think as the convener touched on, Mr. Beattie, that there is a delay in terms of the provision of all of the rich data that comes from the census and the delivery of public services. So it's something of a theoretical risk. I think that there's perhaps a longer term thinking as well, and this will come into the government and parliament's thoughts about when to undertake the next census, whether it's a 9-year gap and to revert back to the 31 or 21, 31 timescales and so forth, or whether to make it a 10-year period. Perhaps, and this is really a question for statisticians to have a view on as to whether to come back into sync with other parts of the UK or whether to sustain a 10-year cycle for the public engagement in the census. So those would be what I would offer as potential considerations as some of the risks. Finances, no doubt, to still be managed through to the delivery of the census and then the evaluation period thereafter.
Thank you.
Thanks very much indeed. Craig Hoy, I'm going to introduce Craig to ask some questions.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Mr. Boyle. I'd just like to maybe just probe a little bit deeper into the additional costs of delaying the census to make sure that actually the costs are because of a delay and not that the project was kind of going off kilter prior to that. And your report tells us that moving the census from March 2021 to 2022 will cost an additional £21.6 million. Which is about 20% of the overall cost of the programme, £14.4 million of which, of that increase, is due to the cost of goods, an increase in the cost of goods and extending supplier contracts. Could you perhaps provide more detail of these costs? And do you have any concern that perhaps the way that those contracts were framed means that people effectively are perhaps now sitting there being paid for doing nothing rather than producing more? As a result of the delay.
Thanks, Mr. Hoy. Graham Sampson has got some of the detail and the analysis behind the additional 21.6, and I'll ask Graham to come in a second or two. You're right when you say that NRS's communication around what's behind the cost refers to contracts, goods, services. We discussed already this morning that the NRS has accessed external support for the delivery of the project, whether it's ICT, project management expertise. So these will be contracts that were in place that would have had an anticipated conclusion date that have had to be extended. Whether those ought to have been anticipated, and as the committee will be familiar, that many public contracts have in place an anticipated original term and then allow for a plus one or a plus two in some circumstances. Factors behind these contract extensions will be part of that discussion that have led to the additional cost. In terms of the detail behind that, there'll be aspects of staff cost components, but I'll invite Graham in just to take the committee through some of the detail behind those additional cost increases. Graham.
Mr. Sampson, I think we can't hear you at the moment. We'll try and fix that. You might have to start again, I'm afraid. No, we're still not able to hear you. I wonder, Craig, whether you want to press on either with supplementary to that question or onto your next question, or whether Stephen used the board want to come back in.
Yeah, apologies for the technology. Thanks, Convener.
I'll try and give Mr. Hoy a bit more detail. We've seen some analysis, and I think that there is the NRS are tracking these costs, so they are reporting them and subject to their governance arrangements through their own audit and risk committee. The most recent assessment refers to cost for the online collection instrument, the data collection operational management system, some of the printing and paper, but predominantly cost for extending contracts for project management support and internal staff costs. So a range of factors. If we can come back to the committee in writing, if it's helpful, just to give a bit more some of the specific analysis behind that cost. If I may, Mr. Roy, one of the things we mentioned in the report that is the need for careful management of some of these additional costs. At the time of publication, we referred to that earlier on in the year that there was a 1.5 million further cost pressure in terms of this, but this is being managed down to £500,000 additional cost. We understand that that's still the case. So challenges, cost pressures remaining, but broadly within the overall frame of the 21.6 million that was mentioned.
Had the census gone ahead in 2021, there obviously would have been costs for COVID-19 mitigations. Do you have a view on what those additional costs and expenses might have been? And would you ordinarily have expected the NRS to have quantified them?
So we, as you know, we report in the section 22 that NRS hasn't quantified those costs as to what the additional cost of delivering a census during a pandemic might be. So I think what we're saying there is that it's not a case of an additional 21.6 million or nothing. There would have been additional costs regardless. Whether those costs were able to be calculated with any degree of reliability so that it would inform decision making, I think it's a difficult one to say. Perhaps for NRS to express a view on, but when we see the options appraisal, the analysis, we haven't seen any costs of what it might have cost to deliver the pandemic during 2021 in the midst of the pandemic. So again, a further perhaps a line of inquiry the committee would wish to pursue with NRS itself.
And you referred to the 1.5 million pounds in financial pressures, which you said have now reduced to £500,000 through mitigation actions. Can you give the committee some impression of what those mitigation actions are and if they're ongoing? And also, do you have any certainty at the moment that those actions will bring financial balance in the forthcoming financial year?
I'll try to see if Graham can maybe supplement a bit of the detail of kind of what they've undertaken on the 1.5 down to £500,000. But to answer your second part of your question, probably not able and maybe wouldn't even expect NRS to give you that categoric assurance that they can actually deliver it on budget at this stage. I think there's too many variables at the moment, and I know we've mentioned it a number of times already this morning that it still remains a large, complex project. Although, I think it is really positive news to see that the latest assurance review suggests that it's now in the amber green status. It doesn't detract from the fact it's still going to need careful management through to Census Day itself and beyond. But I'll see if Graham can just say a little bit more detail on kind of what they've done to manage the cost pressures in year.
I think I apologise to Graham Sampson. We're not sure whether it's our end or your end, but I'm afraid we can't hear you. I think the undertaking by the Auditor General to perhaps provide us with some written evidence, which I suspect, Mr. Sampson, you might be asked to write, would be useful to us. So I apologise that we haven't been able to hear you. But Craig, do you want to continue?
Just a final question. You alluded earlier to another possible delay to the census. Do you know whether or not anything has been done in the interim from the first delay till now to look again at those contracts to make provision for a delay that might not impact the finances of NRS quite in such an extreme way as the first delay seems to have presented?
So I think that feels like a potentially significant risk, Mr. Hoy, that we've seen the additional cost incurred as a result of the extension of some of these contracts by virtue of the first delay. So in the event that the census isn't able to happen in March 2022, whether it's COVID or other circumstances, and the fact that we've heard already from Darcy say that the routes that the other census-taking bodies took in terms of accessing other administrative data sources that allowed them to deliver the census, that that's not available yet to Scotland, would suggest that they would be in the same circumstances that we're currently facing of extension of contracts and additional financial cost. I think the detail of that and confirmation would need to come from NRS, but it's clearly a significant financial risk if that were to come to pass.
Thanks.
Okay, thanks very much indeed. I've got a couple of questions which, again, go back to some of the points that have been made made in passing. You mentioned, Auditor General, about the Census Programme Board, and I guess the first question I just wanted to get clarification on was, this is the Census Programme Board for Scotland only. Yeah.
That's correct, Convener. Just a little bit of detail we say in the report, but so it's chaired by the Chief Executive of the National Records of Scotland, with representation from its non-executives, the Scottish Government, but also representation from other parts of the UK census-taking bodies. We think we know that the Office for National Statistics is also represented on that body, but it is a Scotland-only census body.
Thanks. And I think you said earlier on that as a result of the need to try and tackle or to recover the census exercise, management consultants were brought in, and I don't know whether that's cause and effect, but there was also a decision taken around that time to widen the membership of the Census Programme Board, and I think you said that was to include the ONS and NISRA, the Northern Ireland body that oversees the census there. Were they not on the Programme Board already?
Darcy can say a little bit more detail about the timeline of the membership of the Programme Board, Convener, but you're right. You mentioned the important role that consultants played in terms of the delivery of the project, the support that they provided to the leadership, the Chief Executive, was a key part of bringing in some of the expertise that NRS wasn't able to access. How that then translated into the membership of the Programme Board, I'll just check in with Darcy if she can give that information to the committee.
I think I'm right in saying that ONS and NISRA were added to the membership of the Programme Board at around 2019. Certainly that was when the membership was expanded and to take on more representation from Scottish Government, finance, and to cover the wider expertise within NRS that had been brought in on programme and project management and so on. So I don't have the details of what the membership actually looked like prior to that. I think we need to check with NRS to confirm.
Convener, we can come back to the committee in writing with that detail.
Yeah, I think that would be helpful, because one of the words that we've heard an awful lot over the last 2 years, quite understandably and quite rightly, is the word unprecedented. But the census, in a sense, is not unprecedented, is it? So you would have thought that perhaps as a result of previous exercises, good practice might have been to include representatives from the ONS, most obviously, as well as NISRA, on any kind of programme oversight board.
Yeah, I think in terms of the project governance arrangements, I guess we've touched on this morning is that this was the first census that NRS was responsible for delivering following its creation from the merger of the National Archives for Scotland and the General Register's Office for Scotland. But you rightly say is that census aren't new events in Scotland. Perhaps the biggest change for this census was the presence of a much more significant digital footprint in the delivery of the census, and importantly, therefore, that NRS assured itself that it had the right level of digital skills to deliver the project. At points, we would suggest that it didn't, but it then took the necessary interventions to do so.
Thank you. And I just want to go back, because I think Mr. Beattie was was pursuing a really significant line of questioning, and that is about was NRS refused access to HMRC data or DWP data or not? Was it requested or not? And then I think Darshi said that that was because ONS had started earlier on in putting together data sharing agreements with those bodies. And I think Darshi then said that NRS is now starting to do that. I guess the question arises then, why didn't NRS start at the same time as ONS to do that as a matter of good practice? And secondly, will that will we have in place in time for the census in March 2022 data sharing agreements that would allow for the enrichment of the data that's collected through digital and other means as a result of the exercise when it takes place in March?
Taking those questions in reverse order, Convener, I think as Darshi suggested in her responses that NRS won't have those data sharing agreements in place, and actually it's at the early stages, so I think it's our assumption that that won't be the case. But NRS, of course, will be able to confirm that to the committee if you wish to pursue it with them. And then similarly, I think it's also a question for NRS as to why its arrangements for a contingency of accessing alternative sources of data through administrative data weren't operating to the same timescales as other parts of the UK. I think building on Darshi's point, it looks like NRS started that exercise at an earlier stage, or it was a more central component of its statistics collection methodology than was the case in Scotland. The merits or demerits of those, NRS would be better placed to advise the committee.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. I think Darshi does want to come in just to give us a bit more detail on that. So Darshi, if you want to address the committee.
Thank you. It was just to add that my understanding is that the ONS project to get access to these other sources of data is a larger project than just relating to the census. So it wasn't one that they initiated with the main aim being to have access to this data to supplement the census data. It was a wider statistical data collection project which had the advantage that it would also mean that they had access to this data for the census. And I don't know exactly when Scotland started to get involved in these discussions about taking a similar route, but NRS would be able to provide you with more detail on that.
Thank you very much, and we will put those points to NRS when they come before us. I now want to turn to Willie Coffey, who is joining us remotely, but Willie's got a number of questions which he wants to put.
Thank you, Convener, and I hope everyone can hear me. I just wanted to firstly ask the Auditor General about whether we're intending to do most of the census still online. That was the intention. I'm wondering if it's still the intention. And to ask that there's a legal obligation, isn't there, to complete a census. So how can that obligation be fulfilled if people don't have access to IT to complete it online?
Morning, Mr. Coffey. Yes, there is NRS intention that most of Scotland's population will complete the census online. And in addressing the obligation that's upon all of us as citizens to complete it, it's not exclusively online. So there still will be provision for people to complete the census in paper. And I think also that there is sufficient support around that there will the remains part of the NRS plan that there will be a field force of 3,500 people who will be able to support households that need it in the completion of the census, either on a paper copy or using alternative devices. So I think there's a range of ways that will allow everybody that is able to participate to do so.
And will they extend the deadline if if people don't feel that they can complete it online and so forth, and how do they get the paper version and all of that stuff, Stephen? Will there be an extension to the deadline to accommodate that issue?
I'm not sure I know the answer to that, Mr. Coffey, actually, whether there will be a provision in, you know, the arrangements for March 22 to extend completion rates to allow for any circumstances that people find themselves in. If I may, I'll just turn to colleagues. Perhaps Asif might be able just to say a wee bit more about how NRS intend to manage the events in the days around the census.
Thank you, Auditor General. So, in terms of the deadline, as you're aware, that the census is taken at a point in time on the date, and the households are expected to complete who was in that particular household at that point in time. I'm not aware if there is kind of any deadlines to when they would need to complete. I mean, you're not expected to complete the census form at that point, and there's clearly can be done the following day, the following week. And in terms of support, the field force would be available either to go back to households to see if people hadn't completed it, if they needed additional help. So I'm not sure if, you know, the actual sort of any deadline other than what's the kind of normal deadline, you know, time allowed to complete the documentation as in previous censuses.
It's just always one of our concerns, convener, that people who aren't within the whole digital arena can still participate and don't feel that there's a barrier being placed upon them in order to complete this. So I think we'll just have to see how this progresses as it goes. I wonder, Stephen, if I could just ask another couple of questions on the technical assurance framework that Colin was leading on earlier. It's simply to ask, I think Darcy said that the current status of the review on the framework is ambergreen. What are the amber parts of the review, and do we have any concerns in there? Could you maybe start with that, please?
An ambergreen assessment at this stage of the project is very high levels of assurance, Mr. Coffey, in terms of a complex project such as this. We refer in the report that that when the ONS went live with their census earlier this year, that their assurance framework had given their review an amber rating. So, you know, Scotland has been offered even higher levels of assurance. At the earlier stages of the most recent technical assurance review judgment prior to the one that's just come out over the course of the past few days, was amber, that included recommendations for NRS to follow through on. And Darcy can say a wee bit more about some of the detail of what those recommendations were. But what the latest TAF has said is that almost all of those recommendations have now been implemented. So in making a judgment on the different scales of assurance from red, amber, and then red, amber, amber, green, whatever permutation that the assurance framework decides, it's typically accompanied with recommendations and specifics of what now needs to happen to move to the next stage of the assurance framework. Mr. Coffey, I'll just ask Darcy just to say a wee bit more about the recommendations and what we know has been implemented in the space between the two latest reviews.
Thanks, Auditor General. So just to the definition of what an amber green rating means is that successful delivery is now appears probable, but NRS will have to pay constant attention to ensure risks do not materialise into major issues threatening delivery. So this is essentially what we would expect from the programme at this stage. And I think it would be unusual for a programme of this scale and complexity to have a green rating at this stage when we're still some months off the census going live. The most recent review made three recommendations, two of which are to be ongoing until the census goes live. So one of them was about a focus on contingency planning for any for the go live stage. Another one was to increase the focus on communications with stakeholders and messaging. And I suppose some of that relates to your previous question about people responding if they don't have digital access. So I suppose part of NRS's approach will be to make sure they communicate effectively with stakeholders and the public to make sure that people are aware of their options around completing the census, as well as why the census is important. And then finally, there's a recommendation just about preparing a delivery plan and operational readiness checklist and kind of making sure that those are maintained in the run-up to go live. So there's no significant risks that would threaten delivery that have been identified at this point. It's really a close case of just carefully managing and monitoring the situation, and particularly with regard to finance and resources issues that have been identified before, to make sure that everything is managed and nothing escalates prior to delivery.
Okay. Perhaps maybe just finally to ask you, Stephen, just in terms of the IT side of all of this, we've heard the members talking about this and it's come to the committee over a number of years. Are you satisfied that in terms of the IT aspects of it, that we have the skills and experience and the IT leadership that are needed within the project to deliver it successfully for us?
So drawing on the work of the other assurance reviews and the judgments that ASIF and colleagues have made in the annual audit, Mr. Coffey, is broadly we think that the project has had the skills it needed to deliver a large complex project such as this. It has accessed many of those skills through external sources, not unusual in and of itself, but that does attract a premium in terms of price. So, you know, in doing that through consultants and so on, that as opposed to deploying or employing their own staff, you know, will be one of the factors behind the cost of delivering the census. As ever, one of the findings that we made in the 2017 report is that it's important that there is, in paying that premium, that there's sufficient knowledge transfer exists, that public bodies themselves benefit in the longer term from access to these skills. I don't think we're able to make a clear judgment on that yet. NRS would be in a place to say what it means for the future, given that if we're in something of a hybrid style census for 21 and now 22, that what it means for the next census, and they're thinking about, is that a purely digital census? And will the knowledge transfer remain in Scottish public bodies from the experience that they've gone through in delivering this census? I think that's an important part of NRS thinking as to what comes next.
Okay, thank you very much for that, Stephen. Back to you, convener. Thank you.
Thanks, Willie. And I'm going to turn now to Sharon Dowie, who's got a number of questions which really kind of follow up the lines that Willie Coffey has been pursuing. Sharon.
Thank you, convener. Morning, Mr. Boyle. It's looking at some of the recruitment challenges you've had. So the report states that the recruitment challenges were due to the impact of the COVID-19 pandemic, creating longer lead times for the Scottish Government's recruitment process. But the last Session 5 committee had heard that there already were issues with the lead times, particularly for digital staff. For example, 2 to 3 months compared to around 2 weeks in the private sector. Can you tell us the extent to which COVID-19 impacted on recruitment times?
We maybe don't have some of the most up-to-date statistics to share with the committee. the team may know that detail, but it might be something that either we'd be able to come back to the committee in writing or the Scottish Government can provide. I don't think that detracts from the overall purpose of the point, Ms. Dowie, is that the volume of recruitment that the Scottish Government has gone through to deliver its services during the course of the pandemic has meant that it's brought people into the Scottish Government and its public bodies at a high level of volume, and its resources to deal with that throughput haven't been such that they were in a position to do so with a real pace that it was needed. So some of the delays that we refer to in the timescales here have been seen across other parts of Scottish public bodies. And I think it's particularly so, as you say, in digital skills. This is a really fast-moving market. These skills are in demand, not just across public bodies, but in the private sector too. So the 2-3 weeks that the previous committee referred to, may even be circumstances that it's quicker than that. All of that brings risk, because it means you're losing talent, losing people that might say, well, if they're caught in delays of the public bodies arrangements, they'll inevitably have offers elsewhere. So it's an important part, really, not just of NRS, but really all public bodies, that the Scottish Government's arrangements are able to reflect the circumstances in the market. Just to be clear, what we're not advocating is that public bodies do away with necessary checks. We all want to be satisfied that people who are coming into public bodies, provision of sensitive private information, that's been dealt with properly. But nonetheless, I think there feels a misalignment at the moment between the pace that the market is moving and the rate at which public bodies, through the Scottish Government arrangements, can bring people into these posts.
Yeah. As you say, I think that the process is so long at the moment that by the time the Scottish Government get round to actually offering a job, everybody's already taken a job elsewhere. So that obviously adds to the issues. One of the good examples that we had during the committee roundtables, we heard from Scottish colleges. So because of their long lead time as well, they were around 12 weeks, but in NHS Edinburgh, we'd heard that they'd managed to reduce the process down to 4 weeks because of issues with the pandemic and the need to recruit staff quickly and at pace. So are you aware if the Scottish Government is actively seeking to adapt and change its recruitment processes?
Yes, we know that the Scottish Government is reviewing its arrangements and is looking to accelerate the process by which it brings people into the organisation. What we haven't done is undertake any audit work on those arrangements as yet. And at the moment, I would say it needs to be a clear priority that the learning that the NHS has gone through in Edinburgh and in other parts of Scotland, if this presents a clear business risk to public bodies at the moment, the pace with which they can get people in, that learning is shared, and the experiences in the NHS ought to be shared and translated into other parts of the public sector, absolutely.
Yeah, thank you. And finally, the report tells us the National Records of Scotland is aware of the ongoing risks around resourcing and has undertaken a number of exercises to explore other routes of bringing in the necessary skills. So, including discussions with other UK census-taking bodies, are you aware of the outcomes of the discussions that have been held with other UK census-taking bodies?
I'm not sure I have the latest position, actually, so again, I might just turn to Darcy in particular, if she's able to update the committee.
Thank you. I know that NRS have brought in a number of staff from ONS and NISRA on secondment. I don't have the numbers of how many, but I know that there are staff who have been were involved in delivery of the 2021 census who are now working on secondment in NRS.
Right, okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. I mean, I just want to pick up on that last point, because I was looking in the last couple of days at ONS's summary of how the census had gone in March 2021, and a document that they published, I think, in October, said that the main points were that the census 2021 exceeded expectations, with 97% of households across England and Wales taking part. They talk about the fact that the use of cloud architecture allowed us to scale up to meet the very high demand experienced on census day, and it was digital first for the first time in the census in England and Wales. And they said they said the system didn't crash, even though we were receiving just under 500,000 census submissions per hour at the peak. And they also say the success of the Census 2021 digital service shows that large government digital services can be securely delivered in-house using cloud architecture and agile development. And I just wonder whether you've got any reflections on that.
I think that all suggests, convener, of the delivery of a very successful project on time, and particularly that it's been able to cope with such volumes in the space of a single day is very impressive indeed. And I think just the last question, Ms. Dowie, is that as well as there's knowledge transfer from the consultants, that National Records of Scotland continues to benefit from the experiences in other parts of the UK. So I think it is a positive development that there's been some secondees from NISRA and ONS into NRS, but it clearly matters that those connections across the UK and other census-taking bodies are shared and that NRS benefits from that.
Yeah, thank you. I think that's a point well made. And I think if I can conclude with the concluding paragraph from the Section 22 report that we're discussing this morning, and this came out just 10 days ago, didn't it? The final sentence of the report reminds us that significant risks remain in the conduct of the Census 2022, and it is of the utmost importance that NRS continues to monitor and manage them. NRS should also ensure that it continues to act on the outstanding gateway review recommendations. I expect the auditor to continue to monitor NRS's progress with delivering the census programme and its management of ongoing financial pressures. So I think our final point, Auditor General, would be that we would welcome as a committee an update on that monitoring work, and just to ask you whether it's your intention to produce a follow-up report to Parliament so that we can return to this in the future.
Thanks, Convener. So yes, certainly ASIF and Graham, through their annual audit of NRS, will be reporting publicly on the judgments that they reach, which over the course of the summer of 2022 and very clearly, hopefully, after the census that's taken place. I've not reached a definitive position yet on whether I'll undertake a further Section 22 report. I think I'll be informed very clearly by the judgments that ASIF reaches, and perhaps any further considerations or evidence that the committee takes on this topic.
Right, thank you very much. And can I draw this evidence session to a close? And in doing so, can I thank Graham? I'm sorry we weren't able to hear you. To Asif, who we were able to hear from, and Darshi for joining us online. We very much appreciate your time and your contributions this morning, and thanks as well, as always, to the Auditor General, who has joined us in committee. So with that, can I draw to a close the public part of this morning's deliberations and go into private session? Thank you.